Father, thank you for your goodness to us. I pray now, Lord, that you would make the book live to us and show us yourself in your word and show us ourselves, our need for the Savior. Make the book live in me. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You've probably not heard of Heinrich Schliemann. I can't even say his name right. But you've probably heard of the city of Troy. Not Troy, Ohio, or Troy, Michigan, but the city of Troy. You know, like with Helen and all of that. Well, Heinrich saw a picture of Troy in flames when he was 7 years old, and that picture had captured his imagination. And until that time, and that time being 1829, up until that time, nobody in the world believed that Homer's great poems were founded on any sort of fact at all. But he saw that picture and he began to believe that there was something to be had there. There was something real behind it. He believed that, so he set out to prove it. In 1873, he uncovered the ancient city of Troy. And in that city, some amazing treasure. Heinrich became a famous and wealthy man because he believed an ancient account. But his belief became something more than just a belief that something might be true out there. It was a tangible belief. And I say tangible because his belief produced a result in him that affected the world around him. What difference will your faith make in you today? What difference does it make? Does your faith in Christ produce tangible results in your life that affects you and others around you? The believers in the city of Ephesus at the time, right after Christ was on this earth, they had great faith. They were faithful people. They had tangible faith. That faith in them produced results that affected them, and it affected others who knew them. And one of the people affected was the Apostle Paul. He was affected by their faith. Paul began his letter to Ephesus telling them about all their blessings in Christ. And having reviewed those blessings, Paul felt compelled then to pray for them and to give thanks for them. He didn't just pray that they would have better health, or financial needs and goals met, or this or that physical thing, but rather he prayed that they would fully realize their spiritual blessings in Christ and that they would live according to that knowledge. And so Paul said, not only do I want you to know that you have these great spiritual blessings, you're redeemed by the blood of Christ. You have redemption through His blood, forgiveness of sins. You're predestined to adoption. You are predestined to an inheritance in Christ. You have all of these spiritual blessings. But I want you to live according to that knowledge. That's his prayer request for them. And this morning, I want to look at the first part of Paul's prayer. Actually, not even his prayer, where he tells us why he's praying. He's going to give us the reason for prayer before he even begins. Paul told the Ephesians why he felt so compelled to pray, and not just to pray, but to give thanks for them. And from looking at that reason for prayer, I want to see the tangible faith that the Ephesians believers displayed. I want to understand what tangible faith is, what real faith is, and what it does in us. And so let's look at this passage of Scripture, Ephesians chapter 1, if you're not there with me yet. Ephesians chapter 1, we're going to look at verse 15 and verse 16. Ephesians 1, verses 15 through 16, the Bible says, "Wherefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and love unto all the saints, cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers." Tangible faith. It acts. It moves. It works. It's visible. It makes a noticeable difference. What does it do in you? Well, what is tangible faith? Tangible faith loves Jesus for who he is and for who is his. That sounds weird, doesn't it? Tangible faith loves Jesus for who he is and who is his. In other words, they love Jesus as he is. And tangible faith loves other Christians. It loves Christ and loves his people. Loves Jesus for who he is and who is his. Tangible faith is expressed in that type of love. Tangible faith is faith that can be perceived, can be seen. It's faith that affects us and others. Here he says, wherefore I also, after I heard of your faith, this is Paul speaking, he says, I heard of your faith, and now I cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you always in my prayers. Paul had found out about the believers in Ephesus, and he found out about their faith. He heard about it while he was in prison. Remember, this is a prison epistle. And he had not seen these people in maybe 3 or 4 years. And now he's in prison, and he had invested 3 years of his life in this location, on this church. And in Acts chapter 20 and verse 31, he says to the elders of the church of Ephesus, he says, watch and remember that by the space of 3 years, I cease not to warn everyone night and day with tears. Paul was personally and emotionally invested in the church at Ephesus. He loved those people. And later, Paul would... He would come back by and he would talk to the elders of that church and more fully train them to carry out their ministry. Why? He loved that church. And now here he sits in prison and maybe he received a letter from one of the elders of the church giving a report of how the church was doing and the progress of the church, how they were growing in love for Christ. Or perhaps maybe someone from Ephesus came to Rome and visited him while he was there under house arrest. And maybe they came to him and paid him a visit. And they got to talking about, hey, how's brother so-and-so doing? Oh, you know, the Lord is really working in his life. And here's how the church is doing. You can see that kind of conversation maybe going on between them. In any case, Paul came to know about the faith of the Ephesian elders. That knowledge came to him there in prison. And the Ephesians' faith affected him. It was a faith that got a hold of his attention and it affected him. Here he says in verse 16, I've heard about this faith, and now I cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers. How did their faith affect him? Well, Paul heard of this faith. When he heard of it, it provoked him to thankfulness. And that's how their faith affected him. He became thankful when he heard about it. It produced gratitude in him. I'm sure Paul was already praying for them. You can't invest 3 years of your life and countless blood, sweat, and tears and all of that stuff. You can't invest that in people's life and then just not pray for them. I'm sure Paul was praying for these believers here in the Ephesian church on a regular basis. But when he heard their faith, he was provoked in his prayers now when he goes to the Lord. And I'm sure he might have said to the Lord in prayer before that time, Lord, thank you for these people. I'm sure he was grateful. But now he's praying in such a specific way. Lord, I'm thankful to hear of the progress that they're making, of their faith growing in Christ and their love toward the other saints. And Paul is provoked to thanks because he invested so much time in them, and now he's seeing the fruit of the Holy Spirit working in their lives, and that has affected him. What causes you to give thanks for something? What makes you thankful? Well, gratitude. Sometimes you're thankful for the person who gave to you. Someone gave to you, you're thankful for that person. You ever heard the term, it's the thought that counts? Sometimes a gift doesn't even have to be that good. Parents, you know this, right? Your young child gives you a gift. It's a drawing. And it's not, it's not Michelangelo. It's not, the best art the world has ever seen. But you keep it, right? Because of who it's from. Sometimes you're thankful just for the person who gave. Sometimes what makes you give thanks, sometimes joy or happiness does. You're thankful for the gift given. Sometimes someone just knows what to give. They've given you the perfect gift, right? And it's a gun. Amen. It's a shotgun. It's a 12-gauge pump. It's probably camouflage or never mind. Anyway, you know exactly. That was a joke. I really don't need a shotgun, but you know exactly what you wanted, and they gave you that gift. So the happiness makes you grateful. You're thankful for the gift given. Sometimes the fulfillment of the gift makes you give thanks. You're thankful for the effect the gift has on yourself. Well, here, I believe Paul gives thanks because of all three of these things. He's thankful in gratitude and joy and fulfillment. He's thankful for the people. He's thankful for the gift that they have given him. They've given him the gift of this fruit of the Holy Spirit working in them. And as their spiritual father, he's thankful to see that happening. That's a gift to him. And in fulfillment, all the joy, the blessing, the effect that has on his life, he's overjoyed to hear that these people in whom he's invested 3 years, they have a faith now rooted in themselves that is changing them. That is not just their eternity, but it is affecting their lives in the here and now, so they're reaching more people for eternity. And that's what Paul needed to hear as he's sitting in prison. Oh, he's itching to go out and tell more about Christ and to establish the churches further, but he can't. He's stuck in prison. So he gets this report back about the people in Ephesus, and it just warms his heart. He's blessed, amen? How did their faith affect him? Well, that's how. It brought that gratitude to him. Why did their faith affect him? Well, the Ephesians' faith affected Paul because it was tangible. It was real. It was something that... It wasn't just some mystical idea somewhere it floating around in the clouds. It was something real that grabbed a hold of their lives and changed them. In other words, their faith was clear, it was perceptible, it was real. It produced results in them that could be seen by others. Their faith produced real change in real life. How could Paul be moved to give thanks for them if their faith was not something that could be seen? How could he give thanks for something he didn't even know about? You know, there are several concepts of faith in this world. Faith is conceived to be private. Faith is conceived to be private, expressed by oneself for oneself. Something to be kept between you and God. Something strictly private. Some people think of faith that way, and those who hold to this concept of faith are quick to label anybody who publicly expresses their faith as a hypocrite, as a Pharisee, as a legalist. They'll have a name for it if they see somebody express their faith publicly. Their faith is private, and they want everybody else's faith to be private too. That's one concept of faith. Faith sometimes is conceived to be social, expressed among others, something to express only when people around you share the same ideas. That's a social faith. Some of us are social in more things than faith, right? And I tell you what, that is one intelligent young man because he is just clued into everything. Yeah. Look at that. Look at him. He's paying attention to me. And that I'll take 100%. Amen. Faith is conceived to be social sometimes, only expressed in the right circles where everybody agrees. Like, for instance, in church. Hey, we can come to church, we can express our faith here. We have freedom to worship here. And then we go out, don't express it. Don't offend anybody. That's the social conception of faith. But tangible faith is meant to go beyond these concepts. Tangible faith is private, but it's not limited to privacy. It is social, but it's not limited by society. Tangible faith is all-encompassing. It makes a difference in the church building, but on the outside too. In your life, privately, socially, publicly, and totally, that's why it's tangible. People can see it. And people should always see it. Burke Parsons had this quote on that amazing source of wisdom, Twitter. had this quote. He said, "There is no such thing as a closet Christian. If no one knows you are a Christian, it's likely because you likely aren't one." That's the quote from Burke Parsons. Tangible faith affects your life in a perceptible way. Tangible faith is tangible because it expresses itself in two ways, in two directions. How does it express itself? Well, if we're to express tangible faith, how do we do that? Well, first of all, love Jesus. Love who Jesus is. Jesus is Lord. Love who Jesus is. Jesus is Lord. He's God. He's Savior. He's Lord. Look at verse 15 with me again. "Wherefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus, and love unto all saints, then I'm giving thanks." He says, "Yeah, you guys, I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ." You read the New Testament, you're going to see the term Lord Jesus a lot. Christ Jesus, our Lord. We express tangible faith when we love who Jesus is. And who he is expressed in this context is Lord. You know, there's a difference between true love and puppy love. Puppy love loves a person for who you want them to be, not for who they are, right? Puppy love sees them, for puppy love to work, you cannot know the person you supposedly love very well, because that ruins the illusion. Instead of loving the person, you love the perception that you have of that person. In essence, puppy love is loving a person for who you think they should be instead of who they are, who you want them to be, not what they really are. Relationships founded on puppy love usually end in disappointment. But true love values a person for who they are. That's why when a couple's been married for 40 or 50 years, they can honestly say, I love my wife or I love my husband more today than the day that we got married. Now, the more romantic day is the day you get married, right? That's the day with all the pageantry and the taking of vows and all of that public display of affection. And that's the romantic idea of love. But true love, after 10, 20, 30, 40 years of marriage, you say, "Look, you remember the day you got married? You didn't know anything about that person, did you? You thought you did, but you didn't really. But you learned over the years to love who that person is, didn't you?" Well, that's true love over puppy love. True love learns the other person's strengths, weaknesses, likes, dislikes, and all those things, and chooses and learns to love that about the person too. True love is focused on the object loved, where puppy love is focused on ourselves and who we would like to love. You know, many people love Jesus Christ with a sort of puppy love. They have an idea of who Jesus would be so awesome if he was who you imagined him to be, right? And so they just imagine him to be the person that they want him to be and love that. Their love for Jesus is not focused on who Jesus really is, but rather on who they want Jesus to be, a cosmic therapist. Maybe Jesus could be a motivational speaker or a grandfather who gives out goodies to whoever comes to him to spoil them. To others, Jesus is a spiritual fireman who comes and pulls you out of the fire and is on call anytime you need him, but you really don't need to communicate with him that often. That's puppy love. Loving a personal perception of Jesus, but not who Jesus really is. Who is Jesus? What is he really? Jesus is Lord. He says, I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love to all saints. Some people want to have Jesus Christ as Savior, but not Lord. Want to separate the two, as if to say, "Jesus saved me from hell, but that's it. That's all I need him for. And now he can go back to his place and wait till I get there. And when I arrive in heaven, then I'll worry about obedience and worry about following him and all of that stuff. But I got my fire insurance, I said the prayer, and now I'll do my thing until I get to heaven, and then Jesus will be Lord then." The New Testament, that's puppy love. The New Testament does not separate Jesus the Savior from Jesus the Lord. Romans chapter 10 and verse 9 is often quoted, and rightly so, a verse that leads us to salvation in Christ. But if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, confess Jesus as Lord, and shalt believe in thy heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. In Acts chapter 16, the Philippian jailer asked Paul and Silas, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" And they said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved." Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Romans 14, 9, Paul says, For to this end Christ both died and rose and revived, that he might be Lord, both of the dead and the living. Acts 2:36, Peter preaching his sermon at Pentecost, where 3,000 souls came to Christ. When he was drawing that sermon to the end, he said this, "Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made that same Jesus whom ye have crucified both Lord and Christ." Both. You can't have one or the other. A tangible faith in Ephesus that was so powerful it affected Paul, that faith was focused on Jesus as Lord. They loved him for who he is. He's the Lord, Jesus Christ. If he is your God, if he is your Savior, he is your Lord. That's why they were willing to burn a fortune in occult books. They were willing to burn those books because their Lord required that of them. Jesus was Lord to them. Paul did not praise the Ephesians for some second act of faith. Oh, they had come to Jesus maybe and been saved, and then all of a sudden, maybe they had a revival a year or two later and decided, hey, now we're going to love Jesus as Lord too. No, they when they came to Christ, when that Philippian jailer came to Christ, Paul had already said Jesus is Lord, and that meant something to him. The word Lord means that he's in charge. And so he praised them for their faith in Christ as Lord. Now, I grew up in a Christian home, and I knew a lot about Jesus from an early age. Knew a lot about the gospel. I knew that Jesus was Lord long before I repented and trusted him as my Savior. But on that September night in 1999, when I trusted Christ as my Savior and in my Lord, I was gloriously born again into God's kingdom. On that night, I did not have the Lordship of Christ completely worked out in my understanding. I probably at that point could not have sat down and wrote out a doctrinal treatise on the Lordship of Christ, and I don't believe a person has to be able to do that in order to be saved. They simply have to have faith in Christ, because it is by faith we're saved. I don't think he requires you to know everything about him, but you don't have to be able to do that, but you have to be willing to submit to him as Lord. In other words, you when you're coming to Christ, you're saying, hey, he's God. And I understand my relationship between me and God. That's what I'm talking about here. Many Christians only have the bare idea of all that Christ is and all that he requires as Lord when they trust Christ, but they're willing to submit. Now, Romans chapter 1 and verse 5, Paul calls the faith obedient. He calls salvation obedience to the faith. In John chapter 14, Jesus says this in verses, several verses here. He says, "If ye love me," verse 15, "keep my commandments." Verse 21, "He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. He that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him and will manifest myself to him." Verse 23 says, "If a man love me," Jesus says, "he will keep my words, and my Father will love him, and we will come unto him and make our abode with him. He that loveth me not, keepeth not my sayings. And the word which ye hear is not mine, but the Father's which sent me." What is Jesus saying here? He's saying, "I'm Lord." He's saying, if you're mine, if you're following Christ, he's leading. Does that mean that we're perfect in that? Say, oh, I sinned, Jesus must not be my Lord. No. But when you sin, you repent. you understand this relationship. Loving Jesus as Lord means that Jesus is the priority of your life. Priority in your schedule, in your finances, in your personal choices, even on a daily basis. Preeminence in every aspect of your life. Loving Jesus as Lord means that obedience to Him is the guiding principle of your life. His glory is your goal. That's what it means to have Jesus and love Him as your Lord. Tangible faith that is seen in your life is seen because Jesus is your Lord. You love Him for that. You follow Him for that. And that in itself will make it visible to others in a way that affects them because He's your Lord. But and so if you express tangible faith, not only do you love Jesus as Lord, but there's one more aspect to this. If you express tangible faith, love who Jesus loves. Not just love who Jesus is, He's Lord, but love who Jesus loves, and that's saints. Jesus loves the saints. He loves His church. He died and gave Himself for the church. He loves the church so much that He gave the greatest love, the man who lays down His life for His friends. Verse 15 says, "Wherefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus, and love to all the saints." Saints are those who are saved, not just a class of super Christians who have been canonized into some code somewhere, but they are all the saved, all the family of God, other believers. We must love who Jesus loves. That's other Christians. In prison, Paul had heard that the saints in Ephesus loved not only Christ, but that they loved each other. They loved other saints. Maybe even saints from other churches in areas. They loved all other Christians. They took care of the poor. 1 Timothy is written from Paul to Timothy when Timothy was the pastor at Ephesus. And all you look at verse or chapter 5, it's all about, hey, you guys are helping the helpless in your church, the widows, and let's lay out some guidelines for that. They were already helping and loving on the saints. Their love was expressed tangibly. If you told me that you love me and you treat my children like garbage, I will not believe you. Sorry. And I think you would think the same about me, right? If it was reversed. Faith in Christ always manifests itself in love for other Christians. Listen to what Jesus says about it. John chapter 15. "This is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you." Verse 14. "Ye are my friends, if ye do whatsoever I command you." What was that commandment? Verse 17. "These things I command you, that ye love one another." In chapter 13, Jesus had given that commandment. Here's what He says. "A new commandment I give you, that ye love one another, as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one to another." How do you know someone is a follower of Christ? They love Christians. Now, there's two great commandments in the Bible, right? Love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Those two great commandments, the whole law rests on that. But Christians not only love their neighbor, we're supposed to love our enemies, our neighbors, but there's a special love that Christians are to have for other Christians. It's a family love. Because we're brothers and sisters in Christ. I'm not brothers and sisters with unbelievers. I'm brothers and sisters with believers in Christ. How do you know someone's a Christian? They love other Christians. I'm always wary of people who say, "Hey, I hate church because church is full of," and just fill in the blank, "hypocrites, unloving people, judgmental people." They say, I just hate church because it's full of these kind of people. And what? You hate church because of the people in it? The people in it are the church. You mean you hate church because you hate Christians, right? That's what they're saying. And such a person has plenty of room to doubt their salvation. Now, I know Christians can be frustrating. I'm one of them, and I've frustrated many people, some of you. And that is, you know why? Because I haven't got to heaven and been perfected yet. And some of you say, yeah, there's a long way to go. You're right. That goes for all of us too, right? But you've grown up in a family and you know what it is. Brothers and sisters argue. They fight. They bite. Right? That was a rhyme that I made with all of my might. All right, but don't laugh too hard. I'll break out in haikus next. But it's a family relationship. We love the brethren. You know, the more mature your children get, the less they fight and bicker. Just a thought. That wasn't even in the notes. All right. Listen to what the Bible says. 1 John chapter 3, verses 16 through 18. Hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us. And we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. But whoso hath this world's good and seeth his brother in need, and shutteth up his bowels of compassion for him, how dwelleth the love of God in him? My little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. Don't just say love, do love. That's what that passage of scripture is saying. You ought to say love. You ought to say to a fellow Christian, hey, I love you, brother. I love you, sister. But don't say it to the exclusion of doing it. 1 John, again, chapter 3 says, we know that we have passed from death unto life because we love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. Whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer. And ye know that no murderer hath eternal life abiding in him. Isn't that interesting that the first murder was between brothers? Now, I have two boys and I believe it. I have three brothers and I really believe it. And I'm not sure if in that relationship if I would have been Cain or Abel. Depends on what day of the week it was, right? Or who stole the decoder ring out of the cereal box first. 1 John chapter 4 says, if a man say, I love God and hateth his brother, he's a liar. For he that loveth not his brother whom he hath seen, how can he love God whom he hath not seen? And this is the commandment that we have from him, that he who loveth God love his brother also. Now, I do not believe that any comment from me will improve on these scriptures. Tangible faith loves Jesus for who he is and for who is his.